Psalm 100, a psalm of thanksgiving. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Let's sing a setting of that psalm, number 2 in our hymn books, number 2, before Jehovah's awesome throne, number 2. Let us pray. Almighty and ever blessed God in heaven, we draw near to you. We as your creatures and you as the sovereign God of the universe, the God who is so much higher than we are. We dare to come and approach you. We come, O Lord, not in our own strength, not in our own merits, not in anything of ourselves, anything from ourselves. Lord, we pray that we will come only through the Lord Jesus. We bless you that we have access into your presence. We have access into this grace in which we stand. We thank you, O God, that your Holy Spirit stirs us and your Son accepts us. And we thank you that we come through Jesus Christ, that strong name of Christ, that wonderful finished work at Calvary that he performed for us. And therefore we thank you from our hearts that you have invited us. Indeed, you have invited the world to come and to worship you. And we thank you that from the rising of the sun to its going down this day, there will be praises to you across this world, that somewhere in this world there will be praises to our God in different fellowships across this globe, O Lord. We thank you and we praise you that there will be people, brothers and sisters, joining together and singing your praises and praying to you and reading your word and hearing your word explained and applied. We thank you and we praise you, O God, that you will save some from every tribe and every tongue and every nation. Lord, we thank you, O Lord, for the gospel that spreads all throughout this world. We thank you that it's for all nations, and we praise your name. May we truly make a joyful shout to you today. May we worship you. May we serve you, O God. May we serve you with our lips and with our lives. May we serve you with gladness and with joy. May we not grow weary while doing good. May we have freshness and enthusiasm as we worship you. Lord, you're worthy of all the worship we can give you and far more besides. And Father, we pray that we would indeed come before your presence today. We know that we're always in your presence, O God, because you are everywhere. But Lord, we thank you that there are times like these where we draw nearer to you, and we pray that we would draw near to the presence of our God. May we do so with singing. Thank you that you have said that whoever offers praise glorifies you. And may we sing with the Spirit and with the understanding. And may we pray with the Spirit and with the understanding. Oh, may we worship you, O God. We ask that you would receive our praise for making us. You are our creator. You are the one who have formed us as the pinnacle of your creation on the sixth day. We thank you that you have made us in your image. We thank you for the uniqueness of mankind. Lord, you've made him a little lower than the angels. You've crowned him with glory and strength. We thank you for mankind, and we thank you that we are made in your image, and you have made us, and we have not made ourselves. And we thank you for those who believe in your Son are your people. Oh God, come and be our God, and may we have you as our portion. May we have you as the one that we continually resort to. Oh Father, we are the sheep of your pasture. We know that we're sheep, Lord, that we're prone to wander. We're prone to leave the God that we love. We're prone to be foolish. Lord, we pray that the Lord Jesus, as our good shepherd, would always lead us and guide us. We pray that he would guide us in the right ways. Oh Lord, we pray that he would protect our souls, that he would feed us from his word, that he would lead us away from those enemies that are too strong and powerful for us. Oh Lord, we pray that we would, as it were, bleat to him for help, and that we would know his protection and grace. Oh Lord, we pray that you would cause us then to have thanksgiving as we enter into the gates of this worship. We pray that we would praise you. Make us thankful. Thank you for this church. We thank you for this day. We thank you that we can meet together. We thank you, O Lord, for the ways that you help us. There are so many reasons. There are so many issues of cause to praise you for. We thank you that we're in reasonable health to be here today. And Lord, we thank you for those of us that are yours, that we can say that we are saved by your grace. What a thing to thank you for. And oh Lord, we praise you for your truth. We thank you that you have seen fit to preserve your truth. And we thank you that you preserved it over the years. And we praise you that you will cause it to endure to all generations, forever and ever. Your word says, forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Oh Father, then we pray that we would worship you spiritually, that we would come before you intelligently, and that we would really benefit and be blessed. Oh Father, hear our prayers, because we pray them in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the sixth chapter of Genesis, Genesis chapter 6. We'll read the whole of the chapter. It's on page 7 in the church Bible. Genesis chapter 6, reading the whole Bible, the whole chapter. Imagine that, reading the whole Bible. Although I heard one person who, at a conference, read the whole of Psalm 119. How about that one in one sitting? But Genesis chapter 6. Let's hear God's word, shall we? Now it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful. And they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God. And Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth also was corrupt before God. And the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, The end of all flesh has come before me. For the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. And this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, its width 50 cubits, and its height 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark, and you shall finish it to a cubit from above, and set the door of the ark in its side. You shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. And behold, I myself are bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing of all flesh you shall bring two of every sort into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female. Of the birds after their kind, of animals after their kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth after its kind, two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. And you shall take for yourself of all food that is eaten, and you shall gather it to yourself, and it shall be food for you and for them. Thus Noah did according to all that God commanded him, so he did. Our second hymn is on the sheet. It's going to be played over the speakers. Who, O Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? And the chorus, you alone can rescue. We'll stand again to sing.
Yeah.
messages, we're looking at big Bible stories. And last week, we began looking at Noah. And actually, we're going to be looking at Noah in the main message as well. We learn that God came to Noah and told him that there was going to be a flood. And Noah obeyed God. And that's like the Lord Jesus, in a bigger sense, who obeyed his heavenly Father in everything. Noah obeyed right down to the final details, and so did the Lord Jesus obey his Father right down to the final details. Well, what about after the ark was prepared, it was finished, what was going to happen? Well, two of every sort of animal went into the ark. Can you imagine it? Two of every kind. You imagine the lions coming marching into the ark. Two ostriches, two massive big giraffes, two wide elephants, all coming into the ark. God caused them to come into the ark. There was enough food there for them all. Must have been a lot of food. It's a big ark, by the way, as we'll see in the message later. Huge big ark. And finally, when everything was ready, God shut the door. So it wasn't Noah. It wasn't any of his family. God shut the door. There were eight on the ark. There was Noah. There was Mrs. Noah. There is three sons and their wives. And that was it. Nobody else. They ignored what Noah had said. But God shut the door, and then the rains came down. And the Lord saved Noah. The Lord was in control of everything. From the animals coming onto the ark, to shutting the door, to the first drops coming down, right to the end, the Lord was in control. That's the point. And is the Lord, have you let him be in control of your life? Are we trusting in him? More of Noah in a bit. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you, O Lord, that you're sovereign. Thank you that you are in control of every one of those situations. We thank you from the making of the ark to the animals coming in. We thank you that you made the animals willing. You are over the animals, O God. You are sovereign. You caused two of every kind to go into the ark. A miracle, O Lord. You were the ones that preserved them while they were there. You were the one that shut the door. And we thank you that it was another one of those displays of your excellent greatness. We thank you that you are great. We worship you. You are sovereign. Thank you, Lord. May we bow to you and trust in you, the living and the eternal God, the one true and living God. We pray today for those who are preaching your word, whether near or far. We pray, known or unknown to us, we pray that you give your servants up and down this country and this continent and across this world, liberty and unction. We pray that you would be near them. We ask that you would help them. And we pray that today there would be an ingathering of souls that come to know the Lord Jesus as their Savior and as their Lord. We pray that you would be working in hearts and lives. We pray that this would be a great day of progress for believers, for those people who've come to know the Lord Jesus. We pray that you would feed us and that you would confirm us. And we ask that you would edify us, that we may be grounded, that we may be rooted, that we may be firm in you. Lord, just as we need to keep on feeding physically to nourish our bodies, we ask that we would keep on feeding spiritually on Jesus Christ by faith, that we may grow spiritually. May we desire the pure milk of the word, that we might grow thereby. May it not be contaminated with things that are not of you. We pray for the purity of the word of you, O God. And we pray for John today at Tinsel. Please be with him and them. We pray that you would give him safety in travel to and from. Give him the help of your Holy Spirit as he preaches. We pray for that fellowship there. in Leeds. We ask that you would fill them with your spirit, lead them and guide them, provide for them as they're looking for a pastor. We pray that you would provide an under-shepherd, someone of your calling, to lead that work there. Pray for Martin Sellens, the elder there. Pray that you would fill him with your spirit and wisdom and grace. And we pray, Lord, that that fellowship would know peace and joy today. Under the sound of your word, we ask that they would truly go forward with you. Be near them. Watch over them and many, many other gatherings that are very similar. And as we pray for others, we pray for ourselves. We ask here this morning that the preaching, the ministry of your word would be blessed and attended by your Holy Spirit. Lord, your word says that a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. And we ask, O Lord, that your word today would be like apples of gold in settings of silver. We pray that it would be truly delightful to our souls. May we listen with profit and with pleasure. May we truly benefit from your word being explained and applied to our hearts. Oh Lord, we pray that you would move us forward. May we be more and more the people that you would want us to be. We're conscious of our sins, Lord. We pray for your forgiveness. We ask that you would once again pardon our sins through the blood of Jesus, knowing that you're so merciful, you're so gracious, and you're so kind. Oh Lord, we pray that you would look upon the Lord Jesus at his wounds and pardon us again. For we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 572 before the preaching. 572 is the hymn. God made me for himself to serve him here. 572. People matter, don't they? They really do. When you go round a person's house, whether it be a relative or a friend, and you get talking, as you inevitably do, what's the topic of conversation that usually it gets round to? Well, is it not people? We might talk about many, many other things, but usually we'll talk about people. We do. We talk about what we like about them. We talk about some of their weaknesses, but we do talk about people. We know almost intrinsically that people really do matter. And there's so many things that we can learn from people, aren't there? Contemporary people that we can learn from, good examples. And we also are to learn from people in the Bible. People who've lived many years before us, who lived in a very different culture to us, who wore different clothes and spoke different languages, but yet nonetheless had these principles about them that we are to learn from. And one of those people is Noah. And we're going to learn from Noah, because don't forget, the Bible says that whatever was written beforehand, that's the Old Testament, was written for our learning, that we, through the comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. So they're not just good stories that we, to, you know, look at them and read them and think, well, isn't that very nice, and then forget all about them and just move on. They're to be applied. We are to learn from these characters from the Bible. And one of them is Noah. And we're looking at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, because we're making our way through this lovely chapter in our Bibles, Hebrews and chapter 11, and we've arrived at this character of Noah. It says this: by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. And as we look at lessons from Noah and his faith, that's our title, lessons from Noah and his faith, we have five headings, five things that we can learn from Noah. First of all, Noah was warned. Secondly, Noah was moved. Thirdly, Noah prepared. Fourthly, Noah condemned. And fifthly, Noah inherited. And they're all out of our verse. So first of all then, notice that Noah was warned. He was warned. Now what's the connection between this man Noah and the rest of the chapter in Hebrews 11? Well, the writer is writing to people who were tempted to go back to Judaism. They were tempted to jack in Christianity, to throw the towel in, to give up and to go back. And the writer tells them, don't give up, don't go back, but draw near and go forward. Go forward. And in order to do that, he uses various different arguments. And one of them is these characters from Hebrews chapter 11, which are from the Old Testament. They knew their Old Testament well. They knew about all these incidences that the writer brings to their attention. They know about Noah. They've read those chapters in Genesis. They would have known all about these characters. And so it was right that he puts forward these particular instances of faith, these people of faith, and the activities that they did out of faith. And so they knew. And it should stir not only them up, but us up to do the same. We're not to look at these incidents and just think, well, isn't that marvelous that Noah had faith? Well, it was, and we should start there, but we should certainly not end there, because we're to look at them and apply them to our lives. What was it that drove Noah? What was it that made him a man of faith? What did that look like, and how does that apply to my life today? How can I draw these principles and lessons from these characters to my life? Because we need faith. We looked at last week that without faith, it's impossible to please God. We can't be well-pleasing to him. We can't proverbially put the smile on his face unless we have faith. But with faith, we can. True faith, as defined in verse 1. So here's Noah. And we are to look at these as patterns, as types, as models. Just like when you're knitting and you might look at a pattern and a go by the pattern. We're to go by these patterns of godliness that are recorded for us in the Bible. Or maybe the apprentice, when he's learning his trade, and he follows the master. He's been doing it for so many years, and he works out what he does and how he does it. And we are to learn from these people that have gone before us, that are recorded in Scripture, this hall of fame, these heroes of the faith. And Noah is one of them. Well, when God made the world, he gave Adam and Eve one command, didn't he? And Adam and Eve broke it. And as a result, sin is in the world. Sin is offenses to God. And there are huge consequences, not only personally on people, but also globally. And one of them is that the earth is under a curse. Do you ever find weeding hard work? It's because of what we call original sin. And work was very hard work, and vegetables and fruit were not really yielding forth. And there was a man who was Noah's father called Lamech. And he called his son Noah because Noah means rest, because there would be a rest from all this labor, because the fruit of the ground is cursed. And we're told that at the end of Genesis chapter 5. And so they called this man Noah, rest. And what a name it is, rest. Do you know what your name means? Are you interested in what your name means and the significance of your name? Maybe you're not, or maybe you are. But Noah means rest. And there it is, the gospel, even in his name, isn't it? Because just as Noah means rest, and they were wanting physical rest from the ground that had been cursed, there is a spiritual rest that's found in Christ. He was the one who said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." We know what it is, don't we? When we've worked hard all day long and we come home after a long day of many hours of labor and we flop down on the sofa and there's rest and it's so enjoyable and it's so lovely. Well, maybe what happens in physical life can happen in spiritual life, that we're tired and we're wearied, and maybe it's because of our sin and we're not at rest. And Jesus says to us, "Come and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light in the Lord Jesus." There, Noah's name even gives us the gospel of resting in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are so fretful about so many things. Spiritually, we can be fretful. Rest in Christ. In the Lord Jesus, in his finished work on Calvary's cross, to rest in our gracious Savior. So Noah is born, this man called Rest. What were the days like when Noah was born? What were people like? Well, we're told several times, you may have picked it up in our reading earlier on. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. This was the Lord's assessment of what was going on. This wasn't any one person's assessment which could be liable to error. No, this was God's unerring assessment of what life was like in the days of Noah. Verse 6 of chapter 5. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thought of his heart was only evil continually. Wow, what an assessment that God had of the world at that particular time. There was violence on the earth. The days were awful. Verse 12. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. All flesh. It was dire. It got to the point where God was going to destroy mankind. They didn't care about God. There was violence on the earth. People were sinning endlessly. It was only evil continually. And isn't the word of God so relevant? It's more relevant than any newspaper. Because isn't that a summary of the days that we're living in today? Not to be morbid, but it's true, isn't it? We call right wrong, and we call wrong right. And that's what's happening more and more in our society. People are pushing things, aren't they? That at one time, even years ago, even in the generation before ours, they would never dream of pushing. They would never dream of doing. We're having laws today, which our fathers, not that many years ago, would have balked at and would have said, "No, There's laws that are passed that are completely contrary to Scripture. And if there's ever a time when the Lord can see the wickedness of man is great on the earth, isn't it today? It is. And that every intent of the thoughts of his heart is only evil continually. It is. Sad days that we live in, aren't they? The Bible is so relevant to us. This book written so many years ago, it really is relevant, isn't it? Because these are the days that we're living in. But just as God did not leave himself without a witness then, he doesn't leave himself without a witness today. And the witness that he had then was there was at least one man who lived on the earth who was different from the rest. And his name was Noah. And we're told in verse 8 of Genesis 6 that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He was a godly man, was Noah. And he didn't have a lot of encouragement to be godly either. It wasn't an obvious thing. It wasn't, well, isn't it good that Noah's bound to be godly, isn't he? I mean, everybody else is godly. He just has to go with the crowd. Well, no, because the vast majority were not godly. He had to swim up the stream, didn't he? He had to go against the tide. He was a godly man despite the world around him. When days are good, it can be relatively easy to be godly. But what about when the days are hard? It's harder to be godly, isn't it? And it's harder to be spiritually minded. But Noah was walking with the Lord despite the days he was living in. And may we walk with the Lord despite the days that we live in. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And what did the Lord do? He confided in Noah. He told him. And actually, the first phrase of our verse is actually really an explanation of verse 13 of Genesis 6, isn't it? Because we're told, "And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth." By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen. There's God warning Noah of things not yet seen. The flood hadn't happened at that point. In fact, it wouldn't happen for maybe as much as 100 years in the future at that particular stage. So it wasn't the case that God told Noah, right, I'm going to flood the world, make yourself an ark. So he makes himself an ark on the second day, and there's the flood on the third day. No. So when people come along and they say, well, God isn't very gracious, is he? I mean, he destroyed all of those people. Hang on a minute. God gave them so much time to repent. He gave them Noah to turn from their sins. He gave them so much time, as much as 100 years likely, in order to turn from the Lord. Well, if that isn't graciousness, what is? In fact, we're told in Peter about the divine long-suffering in the days of Noah. The Lord is so gracious to these people despite their sinfulness. And isn't the Lord so gracious to our world despite its sinfulness? Despite the fact that people have shaken their fist at God, and despite the fact that they've gone away from his word and sinned with impunity, yet God is still gracious. He's still given another day of opportunity. The door is still open for people to turn to Christ. But he warned Noah of things not yet seen. Now, sometimes we might think that warnings aren't very good. And sometimes when people can be a bit negative, the preacher, people can be irate. What are you doing being negative? What are you doing having warnings? I mean, everything should be positive, shouldn't it? Well, yes, things should be positive when the Lord is positive. But not all Scripture is positive. And to be faithful to Scripture, we've got to issue warnings. And warnings are good things, aren't they? You imagine if you had a nut allergy, and there you saw on the jar that you're about to get your knife and put it into and wipe it on your toast or your bread, it says massive letters, maybe in block capitals, warning, this contains nuts. Now, you're not going to say, well, you know what, that company, they're so negative, aren't they? I mean, look what they're doing, ushering warnings. I mean, look at them. Right, let's write to them and tell them what we think about this company. You wouldn't do that, would you? You'd say, oh, thank you very much. You've saved me from a lot of illness. You've saved me from hospitalization. You've saved me from possible death. Oh, thank you very much, wouldn't you? And as soon as people, the preachers, have issues of, no, you can't do that. No, you can't do that. No. That's what God says. It's for our good. There's got to be warnings. Why in other issues of life do people say that warnings are okay? But as soon as we start saying it from the scriptures, no, we don't like it. It's wrong, friends. Warnings are good things. Have you ever been driving along on that overhead gantry? So they tell you about warnings that are ahead. They're useful. They're helpful for us. We don't write in, do we? We don't email the DVLA or the highway people and say, you know what, you're so negative, you are. You put warnings up there on the signposts. We don't do it at all, do we? We think, thank you, it's for our good, isn't it? And God issues warnings not to spoil our fun, but for our good and for our benefit and for his glory. And here, God gave Noah a warning. And what is this warning? The warning is, I'm going to destroy all flesh. It's a big warning. Wow. Look at this. This is what the Lord says. I'm going to destroy all flesh. There's going to be a judgment for the sinfulness that has come up against me. And what this is, it's an illustration. It's a picture of the final judgment. The flood was just a small picture of what's going to finally happen at the end of the world. When's the end of the world going to be? We don't know. Nobody knows. Only God knows. But he does know when he's going to wind the world up. And the sure thing is this, the world is going to be wound up. We're not going to keep going as we are. And the Lord is going to come again. And we know that Noah is an illustration, a picture of that final judgment. How? Because 2 Peter tells us this. Chapter 3. Beloved, I now write to you this second epistle or letter, in both of which I stir up your pure minds by way of reminder, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Saviour, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lust and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. And this is the verse. For this they willfully forget, that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that then existed perished, being flooded with fire. But the heavens and the earth, which now preserved by the same word, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. It couldn't be clearer from Scripture, could it? Sometimes people say, well, I can't understand the Bible. There are certain parts we all don't understand. But actually, it's not the parts that I don't understand, you know, that bother me. It's the parts that I do. And this is clear as the nose on your face, isn't it? That just as God judged the world back then and didn't say, right, they can just carry on sinning and get away with it and that's going to be it. No. Just as there was a judgment then, there'll be a final future judgment to come. There will be. There'll be a judgment day. God warns us from the scriptures. And instead of being like these scoffers that say, where is the hope of his coming? Jesus hasn't come again yet, so he's not going to come again. Which is awful logic, isn't it? Absolutely awful. Just because something hasn't happened to us doesn't mean to say that it won't. I haven't turned 40 yet, but it doesn't mean to say I won't, does it? It's awful logic. How can we say that? Just because Jesus hasn't come again doesn't mean to say that he won't. It's awful. Of course he will. He said that he will. He will one day, and he'll wind the world up. And just as there was this warning for Noah, there is this warning from God for us. Are we ready for God's judgment to come? It is true to say that when the Titanic went down, there were warnings from other ships that icebergs were ahead. Now, although it's complex and it's not as simple as that, and if you want the complex story, then see me afterwards, but it is true to say that warnings were ignored. Friends, do not ignore the warnings. They're for our good. And when God says there will be a future judgment, that's exactly and precisely what he means. And we need to be ready in Christ for that day. Because when we're in Christ, there's no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. But there is for those that are not. So Noah was warned. Secondly, we see Noah was moved. What did he do about this message? There he is. He's walking with God. He's getting on with his life. He's having fellowship with God. He's found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And God has come to Noah. He's come to him and said, look, there's going to be a flood. What was Noah's reaction? Noah's reaction was not, well, I'm nonplussed. Shrug your shoulders. Oh, well, never mind. Let's just get on with life. Let's not worry about it too much. Let's just hope for the best. That wasn't Noah's reaction, was it? What did he do? Verse 7. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear. Now, we can so easily miss phrases in the Bible, can't we? We can get on to him preparing an ark. We can talk about all the dimensions, which we will in a moment. But actually, we can miss this phrase that's so important. He moved with godly fear. He was moved by what God had said. It moved him. He was affected by it, about what God had said. He wasn't nonplussed. He wasn't like shooting an arrow against a brick wall. It wasn't like putting a football against a wall that just comes back. There was tender affections. He knew that God was serious. And when we hear God's word, and when we read the Bible, and when we hear messages from the Bible, do we take God seriously? Or is it just a nice thing to do and then just move on? Because Noah wasn't like that, was he? He was moved with godly fear. It affected him deeply, the things that God had said. You know, the things of God and the God of the things should move us. The praises of God should move us. When we sing praises to the Lord God Almighty, it should move us. When we pray, it should stir us. When we read the Bible, it should kindle within us movements, affections. When we hear messages, it should move us. It shouldn't be just like there as statues, you know, yeah, so what? This is the word of God. Noah wasn't like that, was he? When the message came, it moved him. We should be moved to the core when we think about the issues of the Lord and of eternity. It should move us. Now, granted, different people have different temperaments and they won't express their Christianity in quite the same way. And the Lord knows our temperaments and he made us as we are. And we're fearfully and wonderfully made. And not everyone's Jojo the Clown and not everybody's an extrovert. And we all understand that. But that doesn't mean to say that we are not to be moved. If we are not moved by Jesus, friends, there's something seriously wrong, isn't there? If we're not moved when we think about the love of my Savior who went to Calvary's cross and died for my sins, if we're not moved by that, there's got to be something seriously, seriously wrong, hasn't there, friends? We're to love the Lord our God with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, and with all our strength. And we know there are false affections, but that doesn't mean to say we throw the baby out with the bathwater and say, well, we don't love the Lord. No, I love the Lord. You think about it. From beginning to end of our Bibles, Christianity is a moving thing. It's a heart thing. It's not just notional. It's not just grabbing a few facts. It's not just learning something so that we can go on to just know a career. No. It should move us, shouldn't it? It should move us to the core when we think about Jesus and especially these issues about eternity. It moved Noah. He was moved by it. He was moved with godly fear. Sometimes is it true that we can have that familiarity of the type that breeds contempt? As I preach to myself, as many others, that thing that just says, well, never mind. Yeah, we sort of love the Lord, but you know, we'll keep at arm's length. Let's not get too, you know, bothered. No, moved with godly fear. It shook Noah. And it was godly fear, wasn't it? You see, why did Noah move with godly fear? We're told in Genesis 6 something very interesting, that Noah walked with God. Just like Enoch that we looked at a little while ago. Enoch walked with God. What did Noah do? He walked with God. So when God told him, I'm going to flood the world, I'm going to destroy mankind, he took it seriously. Why? Because he walked with God. He was in tune with God. He knew that God wasn't mucking around. Have you ever listened to a radio before DAB, and it's been hard to tune into your station? If you use those old radios, and they're really hard to tune in, and it's all crackly on the airwaves, and maybe you want to listen to the news or something when you're driving, and you might make out one or two words, but it's a bit crackly, and you miss things, and you're trying to piece it together, and you know. Sometimes we can be a bit like that with the Lord, can't we? We're not really in tune with him. We might make out a few words, but not in tune. Noah wasn't like that. He was in tune with God. And as we often sing, oh, may my heart in tune be found, like David's harp of solemn sound. Are we in tune with the Lord? You know, when you hear a piano and it's out of tune, it's not right, is it? You know, there's something grates on you if it's really out of tune, isn't it? Are we out of tune with the Lord? Or were we not really listening to what he's saying? Might make out a few things here and there. We've got to be in tune with the Lord. Crystal clear tune. Like DAB. Ah, it's clear. I can hear it. Are we clear with the Lord? Noah moved with godly fear because he walked with God. Because he was close to God. He had fellowship with God. That's why. And that's what we're to be. Walking with God. In tune with the Lord. Are we? Or how we should be. Of course, we're not going to be perfect. And when it says Noah was perfect in his generations, it meant Noah was complete. Noah was mature in his generations. He wasn't a perfect man by any means. Did you know that later on he got drunk? Even the godliest among us can make mistakes and have sins and faults and failings. It's not that Noah was perfect and none of us are perfect, but you know what I mean when we say in tune with the Lord, in tune with our God. He moved with godly fear. Now, what about this fear? Now, this fear doesn't mean that he had a phobia of God. You know, we have all sorts of phobias, don't we? Do you have phobias? Just like my 5-year-old daughter, she has a phobia of spiders. However small they are, whoof, you don't want to be in earshot of her and her ice pitch scream when she sees a spider. Wow, got a phobia of spiders, or maybe you've got a phobia of dogs. Oh dear, dogs, say. Have you got a phobia of all sorts of things? Interesting, isn't it, how people have got so many phobias about all sorts of things, haven't they? Now that's not what it means when Noah was moved with godly fear. It wasn't a fear that he was scared of God and pulled away from God and didn't want anything to do with him. That's not the fear of God that's taught in the Bible. It's a reverence. It's an awe of God. It's a fear that doesn't draw us away, but actually draws us near. It draws us close to God. It draws us to him. He moved with godly fear. He had reverence for God. Do we have reverence for God? Do we remember that he's a consuming fire? Do we remember that he does whatever he pleases? And have that godly reverence. It's godly fear, isn't it? That's what it says. It's not just fear, plain fear. It's godly fear that Noah had. Have we godly fear of God? They used to say to people, you know, he was a God-fearer. Don't hear that so much now. They were God-fearers. Are we a God-fearer? God-fearer. Reverencing the Lord. So first of all, we've seen that Noah was warned. Secondly, we've seen that Noah was moved. Thirdly, we see that Noah prepared. And this is the next stage. Verse 7. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household. So we're told what happened when Noah received this news. He had the right attitudes. He had the right disposition. He moved with godly fear, but it didn't end there. He had affections, and he had affections that led to actions. He didn't sit there and say, well, you know what, I've got godly fear. You know what, me, I've got faith. Sit there, put his arms folded, twiddle his thumbs, and do nothing. That's not what people did in Hebrews 11, is it? Faith is active, isn't it? These people actually did things. They weren't passive. Abraham didn't say, well, you know, I've got faith. I'm sitting here. No, he went out not knowing where he was going. Abel didn't say, well, I've got faith. No, he actually offered that sacrifice that was of a blood sacrifice to God. They actually did great feats. They actually did great things. And we shouldn't say, well, you know, I've got faith and I fear the Lord. Wonderful. Wonderful that you move with godly fear. That's a great foundation. But what's the foundation of a house if the builder then doesn't go on and build the house? Well, wonderful. He's built a lovely foundation, but he's got to go on and build the house. And it's lovely that we have godly fear, and it's wonderful that we have reverence for God and the affections, but it should lead us to activity. Now, we need a balance. And there's a beautiful balance here with Noah. On the one hand, there's affections, and on the other hand, there's actions. You see, we need both. You need to row with both oars, or you row round in circles. If we have all action and no affection, you're going to fall on a heap on the floor, friends. It's motivated not out of love for the Lord or faith, and you're not really going to keep going. No, no, it was right that Noah was moved with godly fear. He had those right affections before he moved the ark. It wasn't just said, right, okay, I'm going to go and build the ark now. No, he had faith. He had fear. He actually trusted in the Lord. That's what motivated him. We need motivation. We need building up. We need bubbling up to do something. If you're not motivated, you're not really going to carry on doing something, are you? So we need affections. But that's only one or. Those affections should lead to actions. What is it if we have right affections, but they don't lead to us doing something for the Lord? Noah actually worked. He pulled up his sleeves, he used elbow grease, and he got on with it, didn't he? And so should we. So important that our godly fear leads us to working and serving for God. In fact, in Romans, it talks about the obedience of faith. We obey, we do something. That's what faith does. Now, God told Noah to build an ark. God told him what to do. And we look to the Lord to what to do. Lord, what do you want me to do? And for Noah, he had to build an ark. And it was specific, wasn't it? What wood should he use? Gopher wood. It was to have three decks. First, second, third. It was to have a window. It was to have a door. They were to have separate compartments, presumably, so that the animals that would hurt each other would be kept apart. See, God thinks of everything, doesn't he? Imagine the lion being in there with the zebra. Imagine if they got together, well, the lion would devour it, wouldn't it? So it was important they had compartments to keep them apart. They put the food on. There were the right dimensions. There was the length, which was 300 cubits. A cubit, by the way, is about 18 inches, if you're still working that. 18 inches, so that's 5,400 inches would be the length. So that's quite a long arc, isn't it? And the width would be 50 cubits, so that's 900 inches. And the height would be 30 cubits, which is about 540 inches. So it's very big, isn't it? Huge big arc. You know, sometimes we can think of this little small arc. And I don't know, it's a huge thing. And it wouldn't have been a five-minute job. Noah wasn't in his shipyard for a few weeks and job done. It would have taken many hours and days. They were to have pitch inside and out to keep it watertight. So much preparation for this ark. And why did he prepare it? Why did he make it? Why did he create it? It was for the saving of his household. And that's a picture of the Lord Jesus, isn't it? With his great work that he did. The greatest of works, he did it for the saving of his household. Because those who trust in Christ, he's not ashamed to call us brothers. And he dies for his people, to draw his people to himself for the saving of his household. The Lord Jesus came into the world and lived that perfect life and died on that cross and rose again 3 days later. And the ark is a picture of the gospel. Why? Everybody that went on that ark when it was finished was saved and safe. And everybody that was outside of that ark, which was many, was perished and lost. And everybody that is in Christ is safe and saved. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. But if you are outside of the ark of Christ and you carry on that way, you will perish eternally in hell. That is what God has said in his word. And that should cause you to run to the ark of Christ and to be safe and to be saved. To actually come to him as he's offered freely in the good news of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. To be safe in the ark of Christ. Aren't you running? Or are you a bit like the people when Noah preached that just mocked him? A flood, really? Noah's off his rocker. You know, you might think, hey, yeah, really? A judgment, hell, really? Yeah. Just as there was a flood in those days, there will be a flood, a final judgment that will come. We're to flee from the wrath to come, says the Bible. We're to run to Christ and the safety that's found in the Lord Jesus. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run to it and are safe. You imagine those people in the medieval times when they looked down the hill from the person on the watchtower and he could see an army coming, and everyone would go into the castle, and the drawbridge would be pulled up, the portcullis put down, and the safety of the castle known. Oh, that we'll be safe in the castle of Christ. That we'll be safe and protected by the Lord Jesus and under his blood. Is that true of you? Have you run to Christ for safety? Are you a saved person this morning? Oh, I hope you are. Because the alternative is almost too hideous to contemplate, isn't it? And we dare not say it if it wasn't in the Bible. But it's true. Oh, that we would run to the ark that's Christ, and be saved in him. So we've seen Noah was warned, Noah was moved, Noah prepared, Noah condemned. What did our verse teach us again? Verse 7, by faith Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, and we're told in Peter, by which 8 were saved through water, by which he condemned the world. Now, how did Noah condemn the world? Now, I'm sure that Noah didn't go out of his way intentionally to wind people up, and neither should we. I don't think Noah did that. Do you? But just by Noah having faith, and just by Noah moving with godly fear, and just as Noah got on with doing what God wanted him to do, by the sheer fact of doing that, he was condemning the world. Christian believer, don't be surprised if people don't really like what you're doing. It's not that we go out of our way to antagonize, but just by having faith, you condemn the world when they don't have faith. Light and darkness do not mix. And when we walk with the Lord, we don't have to go out of our way to antagonize, and we shouldn't. We should be gracious. But you'll find that just living the Christian life will antagonize people. You're like, where's that come from? I haven't gone my way to annoy them. Just by having faith, just by having godly fear, just by serving the Lord. It's what Jesus says, isn't it? He said to this generation, in Matthew chapter 12, he says, listen, this generation, what's going to happen? The Ninevites will rise up and condemn this generation in the judgment. Why? Because they repented of the preaching of Jonah. And he said, the queen of the south, that's the queen of Sheba, she'll rise up and condemn this generation because she came from the ends of the earth to see the wisdom of Solomon, and a greater than Solomon is here. And it's true. We condemn the world. Just live a godly life. Just be salt and light. And it shows up and it highlights, and people get guilty about it. They do. Why is it that they don't swear like we do? Why is it that they're not debauched like we are? Why is it that they don't laugh at the dirty jokes? It's true, isn't it, friends? We condemn the world by living a godly life and doing what God wants. It doesn't mean that when we live a godly life, everything's going to be easy for us. In fact, it might mean that it could be harder, but it's worth it, isn't it? And here, Noah, you can imagine the people, and they're whispering, and they're putting each other's shoulders, and what's he doing? Well, let's go and ask him. Noah, what are you doing? I'm building an ark. You what? I'm building an ark. What are you doing that for? Because there's going to be a flood. Why is there going to be a flood then, Noah? Because the Lord's had enough of you sinning. What? We're sinners? Yeah. And you need to come into the safety of this ark to be saved. See, Noah wasn't all doom and gloom. We're told in Peter that he was a preacher of righteousness. Did you know that Noah was a builder and a preacher? And in his shipyard, he was preaching as well as building. He was saying, by building the ark, there's safety. There's an answer. And there's an answer, isn't there, to this world's problem? And it's Christ. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the answer, isn't he? By which he condemned the world. He was a preacher. He was like a tongue of fire that said, hear ye, he declared the gospel faithfully. Do we? So fifthly, we see that Noah inherited. Noah was warned. Noah was moved. Noah prepared. Noah condemned. And fifthly, Noah inherited. What did we find at the end? And became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. How significant is that word, righteousness? I'm reading Proverbs at the moment in my personal devotions, and it struck me, and this is one of the wonders about the Bible, that no matter how many times you read it, there's always something fresh. You ever noticed that? How many times have I read Proverbs? Many. I've never noticed this before. I've always noticed that the words wisdom, they keep coming up, and understanding, they keep coming up. But the word righteousness or righteous, it comes up so many times, especially in those early chapters of Proverbs. And it's such a key word, isn't it? And I expect it to be in Romans and Galatians about justification. But it's there in Proverbs as well, the practical chapters about righteousness. And here it is here, isn't it? Became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Are we right with God? It's not a righteousness of our own. Noah didn't have any righteousness of himself. It was a given righteousness. And we have a given righteousness, which is by Jesus Christ. He's inherently righteous. And he came to this world to win our righteousness. And when we trust in him, he declares us to be righteous. Recently, my parents, they transferred some money for my birthday into my bank account. And it's transferred into, it's credited. And that's the righteousness of Christ. It's credited to our account. He puts it on our account when we trust Christ. The great exchange at the cross. I mustn't get going, otherwise it'll be a long sermon about this because it's so important. But the point is this. When you trust Christ, the sins of Jesus, they're put on his account. And the righteousness of Christ is transferred to our account. And we have those robes of white round us. And when God sees us, he sees the righteousness of Christ. How do we get that? Through faith. That's what he says, isn't it? The heir, he inherited. We know what inheritance is, don't we? When someone inherits, they possess their parents' estate. He was an heir. He inherited the righteousness, which is according to faith. It's not of our works. It's not by what we do. It's faith in Christ. By grace you have been saved. Through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Let's learn from this man, Noah. Let's learn from his life and his faith. And be blessed that we would have that same type of faith in the same object as Noah had all those years ago. Let's stand and sing our first hymn, our last hymn, 583, Jesus, your blood and righteousness, my beauty are, my glorious dress, midst flaming worlds in these arrayed, with joy shall I lift up my head. Number 583.
Jesus, your love and my life.
how grateful we should be that you made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of you, our God, in him. Father, we thank you for the credited, imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ. Seal your word to our hearts. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Saviour, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.